we know there's no fire drill planned or anything like that, so just the exits are marked with the on the green green back of a white running person. So head out there. And we've also got the fire brigade here, so follow him, I think. So thanks for that. Again, toilets are through the doors down and to the right. So if anyone needs those, I think they're the broad announcements. We won't go around and introduce everyone by name. Everyone's got name plaques that are here. I'll just let you know, I'm Geoff Green and I'm the chairman of the Constituency Committee. We have, clearly there's a lot of people here tonight, I'm sure I've got a rough idea what it might be about. So what we'll try and do is to go through some of the administration of the meeting to begin with. First thing I've got is ask whether any members consider whether they've got a disclosable pecuniary interest and or any other relevant interest in connection with any items on this agenda, and if so, to declare them and state the nature of that interest, please. All right, yeah, sorry. Yeah. Everyone's leaning forward on you, Matthew. Yeah, that's it. So, yes, Wendy.
Chair, a personal interest in item six in the sense that I'm the chairman of Greasby Community Association. However, there's no decision relating to monies this evening, so I shall keep going.
Okay. And I think, as I understand, that's an umbrella organisation that works with other groups anyway.
It does indeed.
Okay. Lovely. Thank you for that. Gosh, it appears as though feedback follows. Okay. I've got some sad and, you know, particularly sad announcements to make, and that is. Phil Baker, the former engagement officer for Wirral West, passed away just before Christmas. And also, quite again shockingly really, Councillor Denise Roberts, Councillor for Court Ward since 1999, passed away yesterday. And that's both will be sadly missed, and that was a particular shock. So could I ask everyone to stand for a short period, for a minute, and remember. Next item on the agenda is to look at the minutes and to prove the accuracy of the minutes of the meeting held on the 6th of October. Can I make agreed?
Agreed.
Yep, agreed. Everyone content? Well, I think I signed it, so I'm sorry. Yeah, okay.
Can everyone
see the presentation?
actually relate to what I'm saying.
In, I do that all the time, it's been good.
In the packet you've had tonight, there's a report which Jane and the team have prepared around the last 2 years of your Wirral. So I'll let you read that rather than go through all that information. But Jane thought it would be quite useful for me to come and give you a little bit of background on your Wirral to put some context on all that information that you've got. Your Wirral came about as part of what's called the Community Fund, which arose when the stock transfer happened from Wirral Council to Wirral Partnership Homes, which was about 12 years ago. We first launched the Your Wirral Fund in 2007. So the Community Fund came about from how we could use the VAT on the, that we were paying out on the improvement programme. So it was a VAT shelter, so every pound that we spent on improving our homes across the 7 year improvement programme, the VAT that would have been paid on that went into a big pot to be used for things for the community. And 250,000 of that each year was top sliced to be small grants right across the borough. For the first few years, up until 2013, this was assessed as one great big pot covering the whole of Wirral. So wherever you were as a small community group in whichever bit of the borough, whether you're working in one small area or covering a larger area, the application form came into the same assessment process. I was trying to work out this afternoon how many applications we must have looked at, and it's got to have been over 5,000 applications in the time that the fund was open. And I think I read every single one of them over the 10 years it's been there. 2 years ago, we split it into five pots, based in one pot for each constituency committee, so Wirral West had its own pot, but there was also a Wirral-wide pot, because we recognised that some projects that maybe don't happen in just one area, they might appeal to people from right across Wirral. So we wanted to still be able to fund those projects by having this Wirral-wide pot. So over the time that we've had, there's been around £2.5 million spent by your Wirral, and it is coming, has come to an end at the end of the last financial year. The reason that we've wrapped it up isn't because we want to stop spending the money, but because we've spent it all. We've completed our improvement programme, as mentioned right at the start. The spend on the improvement programme attracted the VAT that we could recover that could go into the pot. So if we're not doing that designated list of work anymore, there's no VAT to put back into the pot. So that's why your Wirral isn't around. So this will be the last report on it for this area. But it's not all just stats and numbers and doom and gloom, because you know, the funding's not there now. Over the 10 years, there have been some amazing projects. And there's some that have really stood out, not necessarily for being the biggest, the best, the most amazing outcomes, but just because there's something different about them. And three of my favourites all actually come from projects in the Wirral West area.
Which is the right thing.
And if I was in Wallasey, Birkenhead or Wirral South, my three favourite projects would have come from there. I think the first one to mention is what is quite simply the cutest funding application I have ever read. When you're reading a lot of them and you're spending a whole day locked in a small room looking at the same form, it gets a bit Groundhog Day sometimes. There's only so many descriptions of a new tea urn for our kitchen that you can read before you lose the will to go on. But then something comes along that is different. And it was an application for some mugs and an urn to make the tea, but it was for a parents and tots group. And rather than applying from the point of view of the parents saying, we come to this group and we bring our children to it, the whole application was written as if it was the tots that were asking for the money. So they went to the group and they had loads of toys to play with, but sometimes they were worried that their grown-ups might get bored. So could they have some an urn and some mugs so that their grown-ups could have a cup of tea while they were playing? How can you say no to a request like that? Wirral West also had our smallest application over the 10 years. It was only for about £150, and it was they were hosting, Friends of the Sea were hosting a tea party for retired mariners, whether they were Merchant Navy, Royal Navy, or even just on the Mersey ferries. It was anybody who had worked with water could have come to this celebration. And we bought the scones and the jam and the cream. And that was all they had on their list of what they wanted us to pay for. If they'd asked us for all the costs, for room hire and everything, We'd have still said yes, but all they wanted from your Wirral was the scones and the jam and the cream, which is such a different approach to funding. Again, it's actually just asking for what you wanted. And then looking from the smallest, your Wirral is also home to the largest Your Wirral logo. So Your Wirral West is over here. It's in Hoy Lake at Bertram Lawn Tennis Club. And when I say largest, I mean it's this big. I've got a photo of it with me in my handbag if anyone wants to see it, but it is literally bigger than me. They've had some funding to get a tennis court refurbished, and they said, do you want us to put the logo up somewhere? And I said, oh, yes, please, and thought they'd mean a plaque on a wall. When I walked into their training court, they painted the whole of the back wall as a mural, including a 6 foot high Your Wirral logo. Talk about publicity, nobody's going to miss that one. But as I said, we've had some really good projects. It's been a fantastic 10 years. It's been a lot of hard work at times. 5,000 funding applications, locked in, reading hundreds of them at a time, locked in a small room, having to keep ourselves motivated by saying, until you get to the bottom of that pile, you can't have another cup of tea. It worked. But we've shown that with a small amount of funding, you can make a really big difference, whether it's to helping people get together to reduce isolation and meet other people that have got a shared history, whether it's improving people's fitness by having a tennis court that people can access, or even just something as simple as letting the grown-ups have a cup of tea so they don't get bored while the kids are playing. In the report, you can see the projects from the last 2 years here in Wirral West, and I'm sure you'll agree, if you look through it, there are some absolutely fantastic examples of what a community can do.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Sally. And thank you for the work you and the team have done in terms of putting that together. So, thank you very much. Can I just invite Jane to present the reference?
Smaller local communities put in place, notably plus force in essence. So what does that really mean to you and your community policing? Well, community policing is now what used to be called neighbourhood policing, and you'll be familiar with that. In fact, I think my predecessor sitting in London, some of Brian Griffiths. But neighbourhood policing does no longer exists. Okay, so what it means to you is that each area doesn't have a dedicated police officer or PCSO anymore. We govern or we police to threat harm and risk. So simply, that means that where there's an issue, a difficulty, that's where my staff will be. And so if there's an issue in West Cllr, then that's where they're going to be. If it's in Woodchurch, then that's where they're going to be. And so that we can resolve the problems there and then. So that's the main difference really. So why has this come about? Okay, well, all public services are challenged at the moment, just with funding and to make savings, etc. And the police is no different. We've had to make savings of something like 70 million since 2010. And I think there's about 25 million more to be found in the next 3 years. And so we've had to do things differently. Okay? And it's been a good opportunity for us as well, because there's been a lot of waste. We can do things in a different way. We can think about things in a different way. But also what I want to tell you really is that our service and commitment to you will never waver. If there's an emergency, you will get an emergency response. Okay? So if you didn't bill 999, there will be somebody there. We still have a team of detectives that work on the Wirral, and they will deal with your issues. But because we're now borderless, if there's a 999 call, for example, and the closest patrol to here comes from Liverpool through the tunnel, then that's where we'll bring them from. So the closest patrol we'll use. So we're not sort of just relying on Wirral patrols to police Wirral. Okay? The same with detectives. If there's an issue that we have here, if a detective from Liverpool has got special skills that we need to use here, we'll drag them over and use them, whereas we wouldn't before. We'd be self-sufficient. We also have a unit called the Tactical Team, which is our enforcement arm really. So say we've got a problem with burglary or vehicle crime, etc., etc., then we've got a number of officers, 50 in strength, that we can utilise to tackle that problem. But if we go back to what I said before, we're a borderless force. Often we're governed by a central commander in Liverpool. So wherever the threat, harm and risk is, that's where we will be sending our staff. And so that's very basically what the changes is now. We have a smaller team, as the community inspector, have a smaller team, and a big geographical area. So my area covers Wallasey and West Wirral, so it's a big area. If you look at a map, it's all the top and the left-hand side of it, in essence. And there's another inspector that covers Bevington and Birkenhead and those type of areas. So in essence, we've got two community inspectors for the whole of the world, whereas back in the day we had four or eight. But what I really want to say to you is that we're always here to help you. We will respond to your needs. We'll do everything we can to alleviate your problems, but we can't do everything. Jane, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Inspector. I know you've got to be somewhere else after this particular session. So, but again, do we have any questions? David?
Good evening, Paul. Thank you very much for your description of the new model. That's the reason why I'm not using the microphone. You've obviously talked about the matrix management of the force now and the ability to absorb some resources from the other side of the water. But of course the same applies on this side. So what kind of assurances can you give the public here today that we won't lose some of our resources over to the Liverpool side?
Well, there's no assurances that we won't lose them over there for a particular reason.
Is there another microphone floating around that might be, is it switched on?
technology.
The problem's down there. It's gone fine.
Okay. John Scott,
no. There we go. As we knew, it was Matthew.
Hello?
Yes,
right, so to get back to your question, there is no assurances really that we're not going to lose staff to Liverpool. They're going to be based here, my community team are based here. But the other resources that are here, as in a patrol function for the 999 calls, the investigators, detectives, they're based here. And target team, which is my proactive team, or the area's proactive team. If they're required because there's a significant need, and I'll give you an example of that, and if they're required in Liverpool, then that's where they'll go for a short period. Now, you'll understand that Liverpool have had some firearms discharges recently. That's been quite significant. And so we've had to send some more resources to Liverpool to try and assist them in disruption tactics, etc. So, I'm not here to tell you that everything's great, and we'll always have staff here all the time. They will just be moved around. If we've got a problem on the Wirral, we will have sufficient to deal with it. But we deal with threat, harm and risk, so wherever the problem is, a significant problem, then that's where we'll put our resources. Hope that helps a little bit.
Thank you.
How do you switch up? Can you hear me there?
Yep.
Paul, thanks very much for that brief presentation. I'm really concerned about the cuts that have been imposed on the police, not just in the Merseyside area, but nationally as well. And I'm glad you haven't come tonight, because since 2010 really, I've got fed up with police officers coming and saying, well, we've suffered all these cuts, but everything's all right. And everything isn't all right. And the presentation you've given tonight, David asked about police from Wirral going over to Liverpool. But I'm worried about, you're now a reactive force. I can't see any pro-action there, because you said in your presentation that if there's an incident, you get sucked into that incident. So you're reactive, really. The police have become a reactive force. And in my ward, I represent Pensby and Thingwall, which is not a hotbed of criminality, I might add. But the amount of constituents who are coming to me and saying they formed a new number and there's no response, there's been a couple of burglaries where there hasn't been any response at all. And what I worry about, when you say, David mentioned about our policemen over this side going over to Liverpool, I'm actually worried about the police from Liverpool coming over here. Because if a policeman's coming over here and they live in Crosby or Formby or whatever, he won't have a clue where they're going if there's been something happened in Hoylake or West Kirby or Pensby or Heswell. So it really worries me that the force is being dwindled down and dwindled down. I'm old enough to remember the policeman on the beat, and then we complain because the police seem to go off the beat and go into police cars. And now, I ask the audience, when was the last time you actually saw a police car, never mind a police man or woman? And these things, they really do concern. So I'm worried about the local knowledge of policemen coming over here from Liverpool, and they really haven't got the faintest idea where they're going to, whether it's Wallasey or whatever.
Okay.
Paul, thank you, Chair.
So I think the issue is, will any police come over from Liverpool be able to find a way around for all?
Yeah. Of course they will. there's lots of points there, really. When we're talking about police officers coming over from Liverpool, they're probably the patrol officers responding to emergency calls. So they're the closest police officer they could attend. And it does happen. It's not going to be commonplace, but it could happen. And it happened last night. But they will find a way around, because you know, it's technology, sat-nav, etc. But we're not a reactive organisation. We still pre-plan you're still intelligence led, you've still got your community teams, you're still gathering intelligence, we're still working with our partners continually to make a difference to people's lives, to identify the individuals who caused us the issues. And I know that might sound as if it's the corporate line, but it's actually true. And because I'm not here to tell you things that don't happen, what's not, you know, to tell fibs. I'm not here for that. I'll tell you exactly what's happened. So we do work with partners. We are making a difference. You still got community teams, and we will still be intelligence led, and we will still looking at the people who cause most harm to the community. So it's a challenge. You know, there's no two ways about it. It's a challenge, but something that we're ready for, and something that we can use.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Chair.
Eddie.
Thank you, Chair. I hope the public get a better response than I got. I received an email from the police department saying Wirral West is going to be under Hub 1, Hub 2. Contact these people. So there's an inspector and a sergeant. So what do? I pick up the phone because I wanted to ask a question over a problem over licensing. So I ring up this number and I said I'd like to speak to the inspector, named him, and named the sergeant. They didn't know who I was talking about. A couple of days later, I think to myself, well, I'm going to have another go here. So I ring them up again. They said, yeah, okay, I'm sorry, he's away today. I'll get him to call you back. I'm still waiting for this call. Now, I'm a councillor, use my name as a councillor saying that I had a problem for the Wirral in general, not for Hoy Lake we represent, but I'm still waiting for the reply. Now, the reply I got is when Paul came in tonight and said, excuse me, Paul, can I have a quick word with you? I've never met you before. You could have come to my house and had a coffee. We could have talked it over. I know who you are. I know who the sergeant is. Now, I'm a councillor. As general public, you've got less of a chance of doing what I'm trying to do, but I'm getting nowhere with it. So, Paul, I'm sorry to say, that email you sent me didn't mean anything at all because I'm still got nowhere with what's going on.
So you're not replying to your emails?
I always reply to my emails. I email. I can only apologise that the message never got to me. I don't know who you rang. I don't know where you rang. And if you have the number, I'd have a look into it. And do you have the number at all?
Well, is it something we can take? So you can have that cup of coffee.
So I'm sorry the message never got to me. I have contacted you via email. You have my email address and you can contact me directly. And you can do that anytime you want to.
We wouldn't get any preferential treatment because we're councillors. I'm sure that most of the public would get exactly the same level of service. Good. Okay. Lovely, thank you. Matthew.
Yes. Well, I was just asking you, Chair, do we have any other representatives from the police here? Because if the inspector you said needs to leave early, might it be appropriate to offer people giving community question time at the end the specific questions for the police that they might have an opportunity to ask the police?
We can certainly have a look at that. Is that it?
Well, yes. I'd like to have the opportunity to ask a question.
Okay. Yes.
Just some clarity, really, the first thing, thank you for the presentation. Our local PCSO in Henton is called Sue. She's a remarkable person, she does an awful lot in the community. And oftentimes she nips things in the bud within Henton and Fingal that would perhaps get worse, therefore saving time of inspectors like yourself later on calls. I'm trying to figure out what impact it's going to have upon her from what you just said. Thank you, Jim.
This system's been in place since the 1st of January. It's new to us all, really. What I can assure you of is that although you don't have a dedicated police officer or PCSO to your area, we will deal with any issues that come up in your area. So my PCSO is at a default position. They're not dedicated to a particular place anymore. What they are is that they have a default position. So you'll find that your PCSO, the default position, will be still there, but if the demand for that PCSO is in Wallasey Village, then perhaps that PCSO will be working in Wallasey Village on some occasions, not always where you are. But there's, you can contact me, you can contact the sergeants. Have you received my emails to yourselves?
I responded well.
Have you received the emails from sergeants as well? Because I've allocated a sergeant or two. Well, that will be happening very soon if it hasn't already happened.
I suppose it's really important to point more over that if there's a PCSO in the locality, oftentimes when I can, I'll contact her as opposed to one of you. I do that in the hope and frame of your time.
I suppose the bottom line is that we're in a different financial world now. And what we'd like to do is put a dedicated person for every area. Unfortunately, we can't do it. And I can't say that we can, because we can't. So the lines of access are still open to you. You can still telephone, you can still email, you'll still have access to your dedicated sergeant, you'll still have, and because the sergeants will be dedicated to a number of councillors, and you can still contact me directly. If you've got an issue, I'll take care of it.
All right, yeah. Okay. Thanks for that. Yes, yeah. Tony.
Paul, thanks for that sort of response on the PCSO. We had a fantastic PCSO on the Wood Church. She's just actually got an honour in the honours list in January, I think. What I'm saying, why she was so good was she was actually involved in the schools in the area. In fact, was a governor of Wood Church High School. And her involvement with young people was really substantial. And I'm really worried that now that she's no longer going to be there, that's going to be a big deficit, really, in the community.
I thought you said that the opposition would still be there, but they could be drawn across those.
Well, that particular PCSO won't be there, because that's Charlotte Broderick. She's left the organisation, unfortunately.
Is she being replaced?
Pardon?
Is she being replaced?
She's left the organisation, she's gone to work somewhere else.
Yeah, but is she being replaced?
There are PCSOs on the Wood Church estate and officers that are working continually. In fact, today we evicted some problematic individuals from Rural Road, and there was a police presence there with the bailiffs. You will always have the support, maybe not from that same individual, but you will always have the support. But those officers that were working in Wood Church today, because you've got a problem there, may be working in Wallasey tomorrow, and that's the where we are, the reality of modern day policing is that we will react to wherever the problems are, and as the councillor says, we'll be proactive by working with other teams, ASP teams that we work with very closely, council ASP teams, who are based in Wallasey Police Station, to do the very best for all communities. But you won't have the same individual on the Wood Church all the time.
So just to refresh one of those three criteria that you were talking about, can you remind me what they were again? What was harm and risk?
Threat, harm and risk.
Threat, harm and risk.
Sure.
Well, actually, I've got David next.
Thank you. Very interesting to speak to you, Paul, and thank you for speaking to us. My question is a more general one, really. There seems to be an escalating use of mobile phones in cars, not hands-free ones, but to the headsets rather than hands-free. It seems to be escalating. Within the last 6 months, since November, I've witnessed four occasions when accidents have nearly been caught by people speaking, braking suddenly, in one case they nearly ran over somebody. With a limited resource you've got, I'm wondering what instructions you've got and what your policy is to try and cut this down a little bit, because it is a serious problem. I see so many van drivers and car drivers regularly driving along and they've either got them in their hands or they've got them in their ears, and it is exceptionally dangerous. I wonder what your policy is and what you can do about it. It's certainly escalating.
Yeah, I agree. I do really agree. There's lots of departments within the Merseyside Police. Roads Policing Department have cracked down very regularly on people using mobile phones in the vehicles. They have operations for drink driving, mobile phones, people driving dangerously, scooters being driven erratically, etc., etc. So there is a response to every sort of road traffic incident. But officers can't be down there in the business of that one thing all the time. You can rest assured that if an officer sees that taking place, then they'll deal with it. If there's information that comes to us to say, this individual is on the mobile phone, this is the registration number, we will do everything we can to progress that inquiry. But in essence, you know, there is a response to everything that goes on, every criminal act, but it can't be sustained 24 hours a day.
Okay, thank you. I mean, I think a lot of that is, it's the, it's sort of paradigm shift to make people just aware of how dangerous it is to be, and self-indulgent it is to be using the phone, but actually be putting other road users and people at risk. And people should think more of the community than themselves and make them realise just how dangerous that is. Police can enforce as much as they like, but the public should actually be more responsible. Sorry, Stuart.
Thanks, Chair. PCSO, Police Community Support Officer. Now, I think you know, one of the reasons they're so effective is because they embed themselves in the community. And so you mentioned, you know, a really good example of Sharon, but there's lots of other examples, you know, as well as Bottle Church, you know, across the community. Now, if they're going to be spread wide and far, and you know, sent to other locations at a moment's notice, how do they get themselves embedded in the community? How do they build relationships and tackle no crime and social behaviour at that source?
PCSOs and police officers will always be embedded into the community as a community police service, as we are always. Their job is to create those links. What I'm trying to explain is that they won't be in a particular place all of the time, whereas before they were dedicated to a particular location. And so when they come on duty, that's all they'd be looking at. And that was fantastic, you know, that's absolutely true, it's absolutely fantastic. But times are different, the budgets are different, we have fewer staff, we have to do the best we can with the large geographical area we've got to provide the best service to everybody, not just to one particular area. This is the only way we can do it. It will be a success. It's early days. It will be a success. PCSOs will always be within the community and embed themselves in. We'll always have those community links. They just won't be in a particular place all of the time.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions? What I'd like to do is... Yeah, so we're a little bit behind our time. I'm being told. What I'd like to do, whilst we've got you with us, Inspector, is to just throw this out to the public to see if we've got any questions we can pick up. The gentleman in the middle with the glasses was the first hand up, and I think we're going to move amongst you with a... I think, are we, with a microphone? Maybe not. Do you want to try shouting?
Yeah.
Do you want to, if you stand up, we might be able to...
I don't like clock being cut according to its means. If I'm paying a bill, a big bill, for policing, I want the police officers where I want them, not where they need to go. To go over to the Wild West in Liverpool, it means we are diminishing the possibilities of any eventuality that happens in the interim. We won't be able to respond at the right time. We've got major problems happening on our roads all the time, bottlenecks all over the place. Great and sounds, but just down the road here, centuries. We're going to be a menace. To get police to come over here and not know about the pitfall at certain times of the day, certain times of the year, with that roundabout is impossible. We're just asking for chaos. So why should I be expected to pay for something I'm not getting? And I'd ask that from any department of the council represents me. I'd be good to pay my rates because I'm not getting the money, I'm not getting value.
Okay, a good point well put.
I think that's a political question. I can't explain
that. I don't, well, it's just, I don't think it's.
inject some reality into modern day policing is that officers will go wherever they're needed. And if they're needed because there's an issue on a roundabout, because there's a danger, and that's where we'll be. But we have to prioritise what we do based on the most serious incidents, based on what resources we have and what's available to us. And there's more opportunity for police officers coming from Liverpool to here than there is from here and there. And they will be mostly response officers to 999 calls, emergency calls. Because often people think that if you're in Liverpool town centre and you need to get to Birkenhead town centre, it's just one road. The closest patrol